technologies and end uses are fixed and given. Four major assumptions, as stated above, have been underlying the practice of management all along. In fact, for much longer than there has been a discipline of management. The assumption about technology and end uses to a very large extent underlies the rise of modern business and of the modern economy altogether. They go back to the very early days of the Industrial Revolution, when the textile industry first developed out of what had been the cottage industries. It was assumed, and with a complete validity, that the textile industry had its own unique technology. The same was true in respect to coal mining and of any of the other industries. That arose in the late 18th century and the first half of the 19th centuries. The first one to understand this and to base a major enterprise on it was also one of the first men to develop what we would today call a modern business, the German Werner Siemens, 1816 to 1892. It led him in 1869 to hire the first university-trained scientist to start a modern research lab devoted exclusively to what we would now call the electronics, and based on the clear understanding that electronics, in those days called low voltage, was distinct and separate from all other industries and had its distinct and separate technology. Wow. Out of this insight grew not only Siemens' own company with its own research lab, but also the German chemical industry, which assumed the worldwide leadership because it based itself on the assumption that chemistry, and especially organic chemistry, had its own unique technology. Out of it then grew all the other major companies the world over. Whether the American electrical or chemical companies, the automobile companies, the telephone companies, and so on. Out of this insight, then grew what may well be the most successful invention of the 19th century, the research laboratory, the last one almost a century after the Siemens 1950s lab of IBM. And at around the same time, the research labs of the major pharmaceutical companies, as they emerged as a worldwide industry after World War II. By now, this assumption has become untenable. The best example is, of course, the pharmaceutical industry, which increasingly has come to depend on the technologies that are fundamentally different from the technologies on which the pharmaceutical research lab is based. Genetics, for instance, microbiology, molecular biology, medical electronics, and so on. In the 19th century and throughout the first half of the 20th century, it could be taken for granted that the technology outside one's own industry had no, or at least only minimal impact on the industry. Now, the assumption to start with is that the technologies that are likely to have the greatest impact on the company and our industry are technologies outside its own field. The original assumption was, of course, that one's own research lab would and could produce everything the company or the company's industry needed. And in turn, the assumption was that everything that this research lab produced would be used in and by the industry that it served. This, for instance, was a clear foundation of what was probably the most successful of all the great research labs of the last 100 years. The Bell Labs of the American telephone system, founded in the early 1920s, the Bell Labs until the late 1960s, did indeed produce practically every new knowledge and every new technology the telephone industry needed. And in turn, practically everything the Bell Labs scientists produced found its main use in the telephone system. This changed drastically with what was probably the Bell Labs' greatest scientific achievement, the transistor. Yes, the transistor. The telephone company itself did become a heavily user of the transistor, but the main uses of the transistor were outside the telephone system. This was so unexpected that the Bell Telephone Company, when the translator was first developed, virtually gave it away, and it did not see enough use for it within the telephone system, but it also did not see any use for it outside it. And also, what was the most revolutionary development that came out of the Bell Labs, and certainly the most valuable one, was sold freely to all comers for the partly sum of the $25,000. It is on this total failure of the Bell Labs to understand the significance of its own achievement that practically all modern electronics companies outside of the telephone are based. Conversely, the things that have revolutionized the telephone system, such as a digital switching or the finger glass cable, did not come out of the Bell Labs. They came out of the technologies that were falling to telephone technology. And this has been typical altogether of the last 30 to 50 years, and it is increasingly becoming more typical of every industry. Today's technologies, unlike those of the 19th century, no longer run in parallel lines. They constantly crisscross. Constantly, something in a technology of which people in a given industry have barely heard. Just as the people in the pharmaceutical industry had never heard of genetics, let alone of medical electronics, revolutionized an industry and its technology. Constantly, such outside technologies force an industry to learn, to acquire, to adapt, to change its very mindset, let alone its technical knowledge. Equally important to the rise of 19th and early 20th century industry and companies was a second assumption. End uses are fixed and given. For certain end use, for example, to put beer into containers, there may have been extreme competition between the various suppliers of the containers, but all of them, until recently, were glass companies. Huh. And this was only one way of putting beer into the containers, a glass bottle. This was accepted as obvious not only by a business, industry, and the consumer, but by governments as well. The American regulation of business rests on the assumption that to every industry pertains a unique technology and that to every end use pertains a specific and unique product or service. These are the assumptions on which antitrust legislation was based. And to this day, antitrust advocates concern themselves with the domination of the market in the glass bottle and pay little attention to the fact that beer increasingly is not put into the glass bottle but into cans, or vice versa. They concern themselves exclusively with the concentration of the supply in respect to metal containers for beer, paying no attention to the fact that the beer is still being put into the glass bottles, but also increasingly into plastic cans. But since World War II, end use are not uniquely tied anymore to a certain product or service. The plastics, of course, were the first major exception to the rule, but But by now, it is clear that it is not just one material moving in on what was considered the turf of the another one. Increasingly, the same want is being satisfied by very different means. It is a want that is unique and not the means to satisfy it. As late as the beginning of World War II, news was basically the monopoly of the newspaper and 18th century invention that saw its biggest growth in the early years of the 20th century. By now, there are several competing ways to deliver news. Still, the printed newspaper, increasingly, the same newspaper delivered online through the internet, radio, television, separate news organization that use only electronics, as is increasingly the case with economic and business news and quite a few additional ones. And then there is a new basic resource, information. It differs radically from all other commodities in that it does not stand under the scarcity theorem. On the contrary, it stands under an abundance theorem. If I sell a thing, for example, a book, I no longer have the book. If I import information, I still have it. And in fact, information becomes more valuable the more people have it. What this means for economics is well beyond the scope of this book, though it is clear that it will force us radically to revise the basic economic theory. But it also means a good deal for management. Increasingly, basic assumption will have to be changed. Information does not pertain to any industry or to any business. Information also does not have any more anyone end use, nor does any end use require a particular kind of information or depends on one particular kind of information. Management, therefore, now has to start out with the assumption that there is no one technology that pertains to any industry and that, on the contrary, all technologies are capable, and indeed likely, to be of major importance to any industry and to have impact on any industry. Management similarly has to start with the assumption that there is no one given end use for any product or service and that, conversely, no end use is going to be linked to any one product or service. Some implications of this are that increasingly the non-customers of an enterprise, whether a business, a university, a church, a hospital, are as important as the customers, if not more important. Even the biggest enterprise, other than their government monopoly, has many more non-customers than it has customers. There are very few institutions that supply as large a percentage of the market as 30%. There are therefore few institutions where the non-customers do not amount to at least 70% of the potential market. Wow! And yet, very few institutions know everything about the non-customers. Very few of them even know that they exist, let alone know who they are. And even fewer know why they are not customers. Yet, it is with the non-customers that changes always start. Wow! Another critical implication is that the starting point for management can no longer be its own product or service, and not even its known market and its known end uses for its products and services. The starting point has to be what customers consider value. The starting point has to be what customers consider values. The starting point has to be the assumption, an assumption amply proven by all our experience, that the customer never buys what the supplier sells. What is value to the customer is always something quite different from what is value or quality to the supplier. This applies as much to your business as to the university or to a hospital. Management, in other words, will increasingly have to be based on the assumption that neither technology nor end uses is a foundation for a management policy. There are limitations. The foundations have to be customer value and customer decisions on the distribution of their disposable income. It is with those that management policy and management strategy increasingly will have to start. Thank you.